literally share with us your thoughts on all the goings on globally, especially as it affects sports, especially from March when there was a lockdown, and how all of this panned out, how all of this has affected the game of football and, of course, sporting activities across the globe. What were your thoughts at that time when the lockdown came?
Well, we knew it was going to be like a heavyweight punch. And when it came, it was really heavy. Heavy on players, heavy on athletes, heavy on sports administrators, heavy on us, sports journalists, heavy on sports business. Indeed, everyone took a hit. So we are thankful to God Almighty that people have been able to come around it in some way. The NBA is back. The EPL has just been concluded, like some other leagues in Europe. And even here in Nigeria, where we are beginning to see meetings and hope, imagine that soon, very soon, we'll also find a way around it. But it was a very, very big, big hit.
And how did you respond? Talking about Brilla FM now, what were your initial reaction mood?
Well, what we did was to do a lot of study and a lot of reading. Okay. Took words from particularly the Harvard Business School. Okay. Because beyond just talking sports, I also do a lot of reading and now teaching in this business field. And okay. So I read particularly what Harvard University had to say. And saw that Professor Baer of the Harvard Business School recommended a few things that one could do. And we had to pick all that. And that's how we tried to cope. Just for anybody watching or those who are listening, when it's this kind of a situation, the first thing you do is to know that it has not come to kill. And so you must just press your survival button so that you know that you've just got to survive. Jack Ma of China, Alibaba, the big e-commerce man, said this year, you don't look at making any more profit. You just look at surviving. And so that's what we did at Brilla. We started talking to suppliers to see how we can renegotiate contracts, to see how some of them can give us their own kinds of palliatives. Reduction here and there, even postponing some repayments. Some suppliers were also reduced. And then internally, we made staffers work for fewer days. And so you work fewer days, you social distance, not too many people in the studio, some working from home, which is the new normal. And that way, we have been able to cope. Although with some pain, yes.
Okay. What are the lessons that you think we should learn from this experience?
Well, to always be proactive, to always be a step or two above the world. Know that things may come, the unexpected can hit you. Nobody was prepared for this. Nobody was prepared for this. Like I said when I did a lecture at the Lagos Business School, a webinar on coping in pandemic times, I said, as sports people, you are taught to play in a particular way. So coaches teach you what to do when you have your event, when you have your match. But with the pandemic, you have to play the way you were not trained to. So it comes down to you thinking it out. Knowing that you've got to put this on another gear. And that is what we have tried to do.
Okay. You were going to give us other, what do you call it now, tips that, I mean, some other people can learn from some of this. I'm talking of not only sports people now.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Okay. Number one, press your survival button. I know that this has not come to stay. It has come and will pass away. So you press your survival button. And then for employers, if you are an employer, you've got to look at what Professor Baer calls the HCHP, the high commitment staffers you have and the high performers. And then you now open up, it may be imaginary, but you've got to open up what you call the war room, because the pandemic is like a war situation. And so you've got to know that you have to create your own war room. And what do you have in your war room? You must have your top performers, people who can think it through with you. That is also a time for you to stay calm as a leader. And whether as an athlete or anybody, you manage yourself and you manage your organization. So first, you also stay calm. I tell you this. When 9/11 happened in the USA, President George Bush was in Florida reading to some students in a school. And when he was told, America is under attack, Mr. President, he remained calm. He didn't run out of the classroom. What can be more? And so as business people, as sportsmen and women, don't run out of your field because of what has happened. Remain calm so that you can take your deep breath and know what to do. Again, you must collaborate. So you start looking for people who can help you. So you start collaborations. You also must show compassion. Compassion to those who are your creditors, those who help you sustain your business or sustain yourself. You must show compassion to them. What are they also facing? And under compassion, you also must show compassion one for another. So your colleagues, fellow athletes, fellow footballers, what are they passing through? We all have different coping mechanisms, coping levels. So you must see those who are almost dying because of this. And so be compassionate, help them. And again, cash. This is not the time to spend foolishly. This is the time to hold on to your old shoes and delay purchasing new ones, if you allow me to use that analogy. The community that you belong to, this is the time to know the community very well, because you may just need one hospital around the community or somebody around you who can help you. So you must relate well with the community. You also must have your ears to the ground concerning what government is doing. If you allow me to go use this business term, the PESO analysis.
Okay.
P there stands for politics and government. E there stands for the economy. How is the economy? So P, politics, government. What is government saying about this pandemic? They are saying in your office, at home, follow some protocols. As you go out, you know what to do, the advisory. So what government has said, so you don't land in trouble and don't put others in trouble, follow. The economy is down. This is not the time to start something new, except if it's e-commerce based. Social, we talk about interactions in this case, and I'm slightly tweaking the personal analysis to pigeonhole it within the pandemic issues. Social. This is not the time to interact without putting on your face mask. This is not the time to start visiting people. This is the time to stay on your own and do many things, maybe through the phone. And that takes me to technology, T. Technology, what can it do? Is this the time to keep away your phone, or the time to keep data on your phone? How can technology help me as a person? Oh, I'm not allowed to train as a footballer. But can I be watching the training videos of others so that when I'm allowed to go back, I know I have also loaded my brain rather than just stay idle? So technology is key. And then legal, the legal aspect. You want to say, given the way things are turning out, you're asking some workers to go, some to stay. You are being told you will not be fully paid. What is legal? What is right? So that you don't end up in court because of some decisions taken. I remember N'Golo Kante telling Chelsea he was not ready to train. Was that legal? Was that the way they signed the contract? And so you must look at the legal. Not because of the pandemic, you run into murky waters legally. And then the E there, the environment. The environment. So they say this environment is polluted. This environment is high risk. Can I do things outside this environment to stay safe? So if you look at the personal analysis and take football, for example, what clubs first did was to press their survival buttons. And then some did lay off a few people. Some reduced the number of workers. And when it was safe, when the environment looked safe, new things were done and football had to return.
Let me also ask you, if you look back at how the world reacted to the sporting aspect of it, do you think it was appropriate? It was we had the right response to sporting activities, football, and various other sporting aspects and all that. Do you think, and which one, which of the reactions do you think caught your attention that you say, oh yeah, you liked how this was done by the global space?
Well, if you ask me any day, I'll give the thumbs up to the Bundesliga. Everyone ran away. But tough Germans, they were the very first to say, hey, this does not call for cancellation of our league, like the French and the Belgians hurriedly did. So the Germans, when others canceled, sat down and said, they said, well, we can go around this. And when they then brought hope, the English and others, the Spanish, all had to, in quotes, copy, even though they all had their own ways of doing it. So if you ask me in terms of reaction, okay, I want to give it to the Germans because they brought back of the French and the Belgians when you talk football.
Okay. Talking about sports analysis now today, how do you rate sports analysis?
Well, better today than it was when we were much younger. Reason, today's young men and women have more tools. Information is at their fingertips. You remember when we started, take our days in Concord. We will have to first go to the National Stadium, stay under the tree, look for people to talk with and start hurrying back to the office. But today you can sit down and you are talking to you're talking to a player in Italy, another one in the USA, another one in Saudi Arabia, all within 1 hour. So it's easier today. The only thing is that originality is slightly lacking, and what I call copycatism is getting too much. We had the strength to go for stories. Today's youths seem to feed too fat on news at their fingertips that they all start copying the same thing. So it's not enough to become another, in quotes, Google writer. If somebody has beaten you to a story, you say, I like using the fish approach in my journalism practice. If I miss the head and I know the body is still relevant, I go for it. And if I miss the body, I go for the tail. And even if I miss the tail, I look for where they threw the bones of the fish. But you find our guys today, because somebody has just used the head, nobody is talking anymore. You must think out of the box. If they say Chelsea is taking on Arsenal, Eyimba is taking on Kano Pillars, yes, that is what they have said. What did they eat? What will they eat on match day? What will they put on? The skipper of the team, where is the handband made? How does he put it on? You see, 2 days ago, or a day ago, someone in our office called Chidi of the NFF. It was a lovely interview. Educating. Because we were told how the jerseys of the Eagles are made, how they are collected, how they are given to them on match days. You see, these are the angles we want today's journalists to follow. Look at things that have not been covered. Go beyond the surface and tell us other things that will interest your readers, your listeners, or your viewers. But they are all doing well, but they've got to do more. A big, big room for improvement. If those of us who are old school journalists, if we are allowed to carry canes, we will still flog a lot of whip.